And, and I want to thank you for being patient. All right, let's get into the Word. Now, as you know, we've been studying what is called identity theft. Knowing our biblical culture, knowing our heritage. And I want you to go with me to the book of Isaiah. Chapter 45. And like I said, I'm going to be showing continuous different videos of, a lot of this information, people are really getting more knowledgeable of the heritage. You'd be surprised how many people are in the church today, they just don't know where they're at. I mean, they're going through the motion, but they're losing, their true heritage. Now, let me ask you a question before I read this verse. Those who have come, like me, myself, also, all of us, I was raised a Catholic, more or less, you know. First a heathen, and then I was raised a Catholic. And then after that, I didn't really follow God till later on in life. But, you know, once I got into my Hebrew roots, I even went to Bible college, and they didn't teach any of this stuff in Bible college. But I thank the Lord that, you know, I had a secretary that first told me about my Hebrew roots. And she challenged me. And once she challenged me, I looked it up and found out, man, I wasn't taught everything I was supposed to learn. So we need to really be vessels right now in these last days. So this is about to say, be a vessel.
Be a vessel.
Right? Isaiah 45. Let's start in the first verse of this chapter. Because it's going to talk to us a little bit tonight about what we're going to be doing. Again, we've been teaching about the biblical culture, about the 12 tribes of Israel, and also the 10 tribes of Israel, the lost tribes who were scattered. It's called the Northern Kingdom. We are part of the Northern Kingdom. The Southern Kingdom stayed in the land. Who were the Southern Kingdom? Can you remember?
Judah.
Benjamin. Benjamin. All right. Benjamin and half a Levi. Okay? Half a Levi. And the rest of them got scattered. And here we are. Some of them got scattered to Brooklyn. Some of us got scattered to Ybor City. Some of us got scattered to wherever. You know? The Caribbean, you know, whatever we went to. But when you look at everything, and once you show you this couple of videos that we have, they're going to come into proper perspective. All right. Isaiah 45. Are you there? Say amen.
Amen.
All right. Verse 1. This is what the Lord says to Cyrus, the anointed one, whose right hand he will empower. Before him, mighty kings will be paralyzed with fear. Then fortress gates will be open. This is a picture, prophetic picture. Never to shut again. This is what the Lord says. I will go before you, Cyrus, and level the mountain. I will smash down the gates of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you treasures hidden in the darkness, secret riches. I will do this so that you may know that I am the Lord, the God of Israel, the one who calls you, watch this now, by name.
Amen.
So somebody says he calls me by name.
Calls me by name.
Okay. Now what name is that? What's the name you think it is?
Israel.
Say Israel.
Israel.
Right? Remember, he doesn't refer to any religion. Matter of fact, he doesn't even refer to the Jews. He mentions the word Jews and Gentiles are mentioned in the Bible. But he refers to us as Israel. Everybody say Israel.
Israel.
And Israel are who? People that believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, believe in the Sabbath, believe in the feast days of God, believe in the holy things of God, And you find the criteria in Ezekiel chapter 22, starting in verse 23, right? To 31. Those who keep the Sabbath, keep the holy days, know the difference between clean and unclean, those are my true prophets. Those that teach that are my true prophets, correct? Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Okay? So, in other words, and then he goes, and in verse 4, and why have I called you for this work? In other words, God has called us for this work to what? To establish his kingdom in these last days. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right? Now, let's go to Genesis 25, where we left off last week. And again, talking about the gathering of the tribes and tribes of Israel and how they got scattered. And, you know, we talked about that out of the 12 tribes of Israel, actually, and out of the 10, the 12 tribes of Israel, 8 of those 12 tribes come from dark skin. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
So not everyone looks the same.
Amen.
Amen. All right, Genesis 25. Go to Genesis 25. That's where we left off last week. Okay? And the more you know about this, the more secure you are, who you are in the Lord, and again, the more zealous you become for God, right? Isaiah 25, verse 1. Abraham married another wife whose name was what? Keturah. She gave birth to Zimran, Yokshan, Medan, Midian, Ishbak, and Shua. Yokshan was the father of Sheba and Dedan. Dedan's descendants were the Ashurites, Leshurites, and Lumites. Wow, all the mites. Midian's sons were Ephah, Epher, Hanak, Abida, and Elda. They were all descendants of Abraham through Keturah. Now, I'm showing you a little genealogy here, and I'm gonna go down to Genesis 10 to cross-reference something. This is where we left off. Genesis chapter 10. Starting in the 6th verse of Genesis 10. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Genesis 10, and starting in the 6th verse, the descendants of Ham were Cush, Mizraim, Put, and, yeah, there's somebody named Put, maybe that's not, and Canaan. The descendants of Cush were Seba, Havilah, Sabata, Rama, Sabteca, and the descendants of Rama were Sheba and Dida. Now, Cush, if you look at verse 8, Cush was also the ancestor of Nimrod, who was the first Herod. In other words, he was a heretic, right? I mean, Nimrod was not a good person. Amen? In fact, Nimrod is where we get today the Illuminati. Okay? All right. Now, let's look at this. Now, moving on. Now, Moses' wife was who? His first wife. What was his first wife's name? Zipporah. All right? Zipporah. All right? And she was the daughter of who?
Jethro.
Jethro was what? He was a Midianite. Right? He was a priest. Or a Midianite priest, right? His name is Yitro, actually spelled Y-I-T-R-O. But in your Bible, in Exodus chapter 2 and 3, his name appears first as what? Let's go to Exodus chapter 2 to see. You need to know your history. How many of you love history in school? I love that's one of my favorite subjects. And you need to know your history, your biblical history. Trust me, the majority of people don't. And things that I'm teaching you, 90% of pastors don't even understand. And that's that. All right? Exodus chapter 2. Verse 16. You there, say amen.
Amen.
Okay. Now, in verse 16 of this chapter, it says this. Now, the priest of Midian had 7 daughters who came as usual to draw water and fill the water fowls for their father's flocks. But some other shepherds came and chased them away. So Moses jumped up and rescued the girls from the shepherds. Then he drew water for their flocks. Verse 18, when the girls returned to Reuel, who's Reuel?
Jethro.
All right? Their father, he asked, why are you back as soon as today? So basically, if you look at this, Jethro's name was first what?
Reuel.
Now, in other words, now, where do you also find that? Now, if you look at it, I have what it's called. I wish I would have brought it with me. My wife has been using it because she's been looking for, we're looking up all these Hebrew names for our grandson. And we have what is called the Encyclopedia of Biblical Personalities. And it's a real large book, and I love to look at that because it gives you more history of what the Bible really teaches. Okay? And his name, actually, if you understand, his name, Reuel, actually changes 6 times. And now, why does God sometimes change names? Okay, I want you to write this down. The reason God changes names, remember from Abram to Abraham.
Amen.
I mean, that's the first kosher ham you ever had. Is because every time you get your name changed, you go to a new level in God.
Amen.
All right? Remember, his name was Yaakov or Jacob, and then changed to Israel. Remember, God wrestled with Jacob, or he wrestled with the angel, and what happened? Dislocated his hip, right? And the reason he dislocated his hip, because after that, he had a new walk.
Amen.
And when you get into the Hebrew roots, you have a new walk.
Amen.
Amen? You're not the same person anymore. Everybody say amen.
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 Okay? Now, when would I think I would buy my grandson a bib for teaching time? Never thought about that. See, but here's the thing, that now we have a new walk. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right. So, now, because in biblical time, again, let me say it again. Every time in biblical time, a new spiritual event happened. When a spiritual event happened in your life, you had a name change. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Now, we find out that Moses marries again who? The first wife was who?
Zipporah.
And the father was who?
Jethro
or Reuel, right?
Amen.
And he is one of the, write this down, he was also one of the 3 judges in Pharaoh's court. But he was also, believe it or not, a master of the Torah. He knew the Torah. He knew his word. Remember, in the Bible, also Zipporah was able, well, remember, the question was asked the other day. I didn't want to give it because that's part of my message. But also Zipporah was also able to circumcise her son.
Amen.
And throw the foreskin of his son at his feet.
That's right.
All right? And so women have circumcised. Now, how did she knew to do that, first of all? Where did she get the circumcision from? Where did she get the instruction from? Well, because the father was a master Torah teacher. And
Amen.
The Bible says that in the 8th day, you do what? When your male is born. He circumcised his sons, right? Why? Because it's a sign of a covenant, right? Okay? Now you can read support circumcising their sons. Now let's look at this, an interesting subject. In Exodus chapter 4, verse 25, you see this. On the way to Egypt, at a place where Moses and his family had stopped, that's Exodus chapter 4, verse 24, actually. On the way to Egypt, at a place where Moses and his family had stopped for the night, the Lord confronted him and was about to kill him. But Moses' wife, Zipporah, took a flint knife.
Wow.
That's a kind of a wife you want, right? A flint knife and circumcised her son. She touched his feet with the foreskin and said, "Now you are a bridegroom of blood to me." And when she said a bridegroom of blood, she was referring to the circumcision. After that, the Lord left him alone. Isn't that something? Now, let me ask you a question. Why was also Moses not circumcised? Or was he not circumcised?
Also,
why was he not circumcised?
Because
remember, he was a Jew, but he was raised in Pharaoh, but he was put on in the river, and he was raised by an Egyptian, which didn't believe in circumcision. Imagine him being an old man and already had to get circumcised. That's powerful, right? Okay? So again, this is something that we're going to learn as we go in history with culture, okay? Now, everybody say why. Right. Now, the reason for this was because Moses had to get circumcised, in other words, had to circumcise him and his son. So Zipporah, because remember, Zipporah was a daughter of a Torah teacher. And when you are a daughter of a Torah teacher, you know your word. And if you as a husband better do what the word of God says.
Amen.
Amen? My wife pushes me sometimes to the letter, to the brink, because and she knows I know the word, and she doesn't let me skip or, cut corners on anything because you know what to do.
Amen.
So, come on. Once you know the word of God, you're supposed to honor it, correct?
Amen.
Okay? All right, so because Moses had spent half of his life, again, of course, unfortunately, in Pharaoh's court, and half in the Midianite wilderness. He was half, almost like straddling between two fences. And he was not familiar, really. He really wasn't familiar. Moses was really not familiar as well as Zipporah about the Torah. She knew more about the Torah than he did.
Amen.
Okay? That's why also Yitro ends up being a mentor to Moses because he needed a Torah mentor.
Amen.
You got it? A Torah mentor. No. A Torah mentor. Amen.
I see what you did there.
Now, I would like to ask everyone, did it ever cross your mind that Moses was also married to a black woman? Because if you think about it, how many of you, when you read the stories in the Bible, you never thought, right? If you were to ask before these instructions were given out, that most people thought that everybody in the Bible was white. Right? Come on, how many of you would think that? Right? But not now, but back then you did. You didn't think twice. Zipporah was a black woman. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Now, so, which actually, now, write the word Zipporah, because you got to look at what these names mean. Zipporah actually means, look, you see how beautiful. So, how many of you know black is beautiful?
Amen.
That's where you get that from. Look, you see how beautiful you are. So she was basically a Midianite. She was a Cushite, right? All right? Now let's look at history. Numbers chapter 12. So you know where all this comes from. You know I'm not making it up. Numbers chapter 12. Now, why am I also teaching this? Not only so you can know your culture, is because also We've got to be careful never to be prejudiced.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Be very careful. God does not play in that area. All right? In Numbers chapter 12, verse 1, it says, while they were at Hazoran, Miriam and Aaron criticized Moses because he had married a Cushite woman. And they said, has the Lord spoken only through Moses? Hasn't he spoken through us too? In other words, we're the parents, we know better. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right? Now, so listen to me. This is very, very, very crucial because as a Cushite woman, remember, a Cushite woman is distinguished. Write this down. She was distinguished from other women. Why? By the color of her skin.
Amen.
In other words, they knew who Moses' wife was. In other words, Sapphira, by her beauty, and I guarantee she was probably a beautiful woman, distinguished from other women. Now, Moses and Sapphira had children, right? Now, he had basically how many sons? Two. Go to First Chronicles. Okay? This is where most congregations don't teach. This we got to know our Bible. We got to know our history. We got to know who our people are. We got to know what the Bible says about everything. Amen? Let me tell you something. Every culture, let me just make a point. Every culture in the human race is in the Bible.
Amen.
Amen? All right? Let's go to 1 Chronicles chapter 23 and verse 14. As for Moses, the man of God, his sons were included with the tribe of Levi. The sons of Moses were who?
Gershon
and Eleazar. Now this is a different Eleazar from another one. Now the descendants of Gershon included Shubal, the family leader. Eleazar had only one son, Rehabiah, and the family leader Rehabiah had numerous descendants. All right. So basically, you see that he also had two sons, Gershon and Eleazar. Now Gershon means, write this down so you know what the names mean, means stranger. Now because Moses came from a foreign land of Egypt, so his first son was basically called stranger. And then Eleazar, which means helper of God, or help of God. All right, now let's go back to Exodus chapter 2 so you can see more history. Exodus chapter 2, and let's look at the 21st verse of this chapter. Moses accepted the invitation and settled there with him. In time, Reuel gave Moses his daughter Sapphira to be his wife. Then she gave birth to a son, and Moses named him Gershon. For he explained, I have been a foreigner in a foreign land. That's why he was named Gershon. Okay? Now, so we see here a pattern. In other words, this is so powerful how God is showing us this. Moses named his also other son Eleazar because he saw him as the God of my ancestors was my helper. Are you following me? You see, they name people according to sometimes the experiences they have. For example, like Isaac. When Isaac was born, his name means laughter. Why? Because Sarah was laughing when she gave birth. Amen? No. How many women gave birth and they laughed?
No.
Not too many. I was trying to get Sarah to laugh, but she didn't want to laugh. Amen? She was moaning. Amen? All right. Now, who was Eleazar? Who was Eleazar? Who was this guy? Basically, he was a servant to who? Abraham. and was elder, also an elder who sat on the council and controlled all of Abraham's assets. Eliezer had also mastered and the teachings of Abraham, and also a servant who dealt wisely and who was sent by who? Abraham to do what? Well, what was his first a big task that God gave Abraham to do for him? Was to find a wife for Isaac. Right? And think about it, you know, if you read that story, Eliezer basically was a man of God, but he also fasted before he went, because he wanted to hear from God.
Amen.
Okay? So he just didn't go on an errand. It was a real serious errand. So Zipporah, her father, Yitro, came from, write this down, look at all of this, they came from royalty. These are royal people. These are royal people in the Bible. God, God is not a respecter of person, but God makes sure that, you know, his lineage is going to continue in a royal pattern, because we serve a royal king.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Amen.
Now, not only was Moses taught also in the courts of Pharaoh, he was taught, you know, the one thing about the Egyptians, they were very smart in many different areas. So Moses was a very smart man, but he did not know Torah. All right? And his wife, Yitro, again, was taught also to become a master Torah teacher. And that's why, again, he became a mentor to Moses. Because Moses, even though he was very intelligent and knew a lot of things, he did not know the Torah. Now, in Exodus chapter 2, Moses came also to the Midianite daughters. If you go to Exodus chapter 2, you read that. And the daughters were trying to feed their what? The flock, right? And what happened? Now, this is the picture. Everything you read in the Bible is the reason why it happens in the Bible, because there's a prophetic picture of what's going to happen later on. Now, in other words, these false, what happened when they were at the well? False shepherds came.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? And how many daughters were they?
Seven.
A representation of what?
The seven
churches of Asia Minor. Right? And God chose one of those churches.
Amen.
Just like Moses, the man of God, chose one out of the seven. Right? Now, false shepherds came. What happened to the other churches? Why did God criticize the other churches in Asia Minor? Because false shepherds came. They were teaching things that were wrong.
Amen.
Right? And God does not like that either.
Amen.
Right? So in other words, the shepherds also now, if you look at the picture, was like a false prophet or a false shepherd, and they were driven away. Right? Remember that Yeshua also came back for who? Who did Yeshua come back for? Who did the Messiah come back for? He came back for the lost tribes of Israel.
Amen.
All right, people say, well, he came to redeem me of my sins. Absolutely he did. But remember, the reason that he came back on the earth, he knew his people were scattered.
Amen.
So he did come for the lost that did not know God, but he really came to bring those lost sheep back to the fold.
Amen.
And when he commanded Paul and he commanded all the disciples went out and what? They evangelized to bring those people in.
Amen.
So what is that saying to us? You got to be doing the same thing too.
Yes.
God is calling you to evangelize.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Hello?
Amen.
Don't get lazy. Searches of eyes that get uncomfortable.
Yeah.
All right? Now, Moses did what at the well when he came upon the seven daughters of Israel? Moses of Torah, remember, he was one that was given the Torah. He drove away the false shepherds.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I hope you get this picture. See, once you know Torah, you don't hang around with false shepherds.
Amen.
You drive away from false teaching.
Amen.
You don't stay in the false teaching.
That's right.
You stay away from it. Why? Because God wants you to stay focused.
Yes.
Amen.
Right? Okay? You don't want to miss. Remember, the biggest thing that will deter us and break our focus is when you start mixing different seeds.
Amen.
God, you don't mix different seeds.
Amen.
Everybody say amen. Okay? So you got to be careful with that because, again, it creates confusion instead of clarity. All right? Now, so we look at Moses drove away those false shepherds. And now Moses can relate to the seven daughters pretty quickly because Moses also came from a single mother. Right? With children. So, in other words, in Exodus chapter 2, verse 1, let's go there again. About the time a man and woman came from the tribe of Levi, got married, the woman became pregnant and gave birth to a son, and she saw that it was a special baby and kept him hidden for 3 months. So, again, we see the relationship here of that. Notice, born of who? Born of who?
Born of Levi.
What does it say? A Levite.
Levite.
Say a Levi or a Levite.
Levite.
What was a Levite?
Priest.
Right? Born of a Levite, mother also became, watch this now, the mother also became the midwife and ends up teaching Moses a little bit about his Hebrew roots as she was feeding him. Right, come on, even though he may not knew too much Torah, but she was basically instilling in him, because even as he grew up, remember when he saw that Hebrew slave being beaten, he got mad and killed for his brother, which was a Jew, right? Okay, so in other words, he knew who he was in a way, even though he was in the Pharaoh's court. So Moses, again, was also raised by a single mother with children. Now, notice the teaching that we're doing of the black culture. Now, the black culture, 85%, now watch this now. I want you to listen to me. It's not an insult, but it's fact. 85% of the black culture, most women are single. Am I right? Right? Well, remember, there's a correlation here, all right? Now, because especially if you go in the inner city, but what am I saying? If you are a single mom, in other words, even though you're a single mom, you're not hopeless. Even though you may not have a father in the home, you can still teach your children to be godly children.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It is still your responsibility to do that. Everybody say amen. So in other words, why are we even bringing this up? Because you have to identify with someone like that, right? The cultures of the Bible. So Moses can relate, again, to a single mother with children. He also relates to the seven daughters of the Midianites, right? He related to them. Now let's go to Exodus chapter 4 again, in verse 24. On the way to Egypt, at a place where Moses and his family had stopped for the night, the Lord confronted him and was about to kill him. But Moses, again, wife Zipporah, took a flint knife and circumcised her son. She touched his feet, and with the foreskin, she said, "Now you are a bridegroom of the blood of mine." With that, she said, "A bridegroom of blood?" She was referring to the circumcision. After that, the Lord left him alone. Now, we read that before, but I want to read it again because I want to show something. Notice, God was about to do what to Moses?
Kill him.
Kill Moses because of what?
Disobedience.
Disobedience, but he was not, in other words, he did not circumcise his son.
Right.
Hello? He did not want to circumcise his son. And you know, it's our responsibility when we know our Hebrew roots that our children, especially our boys, get circumcised, right? And you know, because that's the way God commanded it. Now, listen to me. I know people have come to me, especially men, and said, "Well, I have never been circumcised. Does that make me, you know, I'm out of the kingdom?" No. The Bible says that's a format of a covenant, but you have to be circumcised where?
In the
heart. Because women have to be circumcised too. In their heart. And what is a circumcised heart? What is a circumcised heart?
Contrite.
Well, a contrite heart, but also a heart that is sensitive to the things of God. An uncircumcised heart and I was kind of cold. Kind of a cold heart. A ruthless heart. Women that are ruthless. Women that don't care nothing about themselves.
Amen.
Amen? And being selfish and all that stuff. And they're, come on, they're because they're Christians. How many Christian women do you know are like that? Hello? It's real quiet in the room. Right? Well, do they have a circumcised heart? Alright? So circumcision is very important, alright, when it comes especially to our heart. Now, because Moses did not want to circumcise his son, but, you know, basically, thank God for woman of God.
Amen.
They said, Moses, you don't do it, I'll do it. So Pura was also a black woman.
Amen.
And you don't mess with black women.
Amen.
Everybody say amen. Right? Right? You don't mess with them.
No.
Right, huh? Come on, brother. Well, let me just go there, even though my wife is not here. You don't mess with Puerto Rican women either. Because they'll get a flint knife and a bat at the same time. Amen? You don't mess around with a Cuban woman. A Colombian woman. You don't mess with the Latin women. Amen? Praise the Lord. Because we're going to get into the Latin women in just a little bit. Now, all women are sellers in their own way. And see, women were created to have a very powerful nature. They were given the nature to be protective. Okay? Now think about it. Women are very, how many of you are very protective? Right? How many of you had a sister? Women have a sister? And your sister took your sweater or your blouse without asking you, what would you do? Scrap? You would fight? Right? Now, if you look, women are very protective. So in other words, God created a woman with a protective nature.
Right.
Okay? And the reason for that is because God knew that one day you were going to have a baby.
Amen.
All right? And you're very overprotective over your children.
Amen.
All right? Even in the animal kingdom, if you look at, let's say, for example, a female tiger and a male tiger, all right, or even a dog, if you have dogs, and you have a male dog and a female dog, and the female dog just had puppies, all right? And you go near those dogs. Hello? Right? Now, the male dog may be hanging around the puppies, and you go around with the male dog, man, play with him, I don't care. they don't have that protective nature. Amen? And how, men, have you ever messed up with your children? What did your wife do? She jumped all over you.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Why did you let that baby do that? Amen? Very protective, all right? All right, so let's go back. All right, thank God for women. I love women. Praise the Lord. My mother was a woman, so I love women. Now let me ask you another question. Was Moses given the Torah at Sinai yet?
No.
When this happened?
No.
No. So that, now think about it. So Sephora, a black woman, saves Moses' life. Mm-hmm. Huh? Who ends up going to Mount Sinai. Mm-hmm. And to again receive the Torah that we have today.
Come on now.
So we wouldn't have the Torah today for Moses if a black woman didn't deceive.
Amen.
If you look at that, I mean, come on, I'm looking at this like this. All right? Mm-hmm. Everyone say amen.
Amen.
That's why when black culture, the reason I'm saying, I'm teaching this, when black culture gets a hold of their Hebrew roots, come on. They become great witnesses. They become very zealous in their spirit. And again, we have to be thankful for again, the very person that, again, God used to give us the Torah. And thank God that Moses was saved by a black woman.
Amen.
Isn't that something? Now, you see, the reason for this teaching is that we could also reach out to every culture, of course, and break the spirit that one culture is better than the other. That's the reason for this message also. Say not one culture is better than the other. And how many of you in society, it's not so? Come on. Because of your color, because of you or where you're from, they will look down on you. And God frowns at that stuff. Everybody say amen. Now let's go to Exodus 18. I got about 10 minutes left. Okay? So there is not one better culture than another. Exodus 18. Verse 17. All right? If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Now, let's move up a little bit to verse 50, because the chapter kind of doesn't flow as good if you don't read the other verses. And verse 15 said, Moses replied, "Because the people came to me to get a ruling from God, when a dispute arises, they came to me, that I am the one who settles the case between the quarreling parties." In other words, how many of you know he was the counselor, he was the pastor, he was everything. All right?
Yeah.
It says, "I inform the people of God, decrees, and give them his instructions." And that's what a man of God's supposed to do. I don't give my opinion in counseling. I give it what the Word of God says.
Amen.
Okay? So this is not good. Moses' father-in-law explained, "You're going to wear yourself out. And the people too. This job is too heavy a burden for you to handle all by yourself."
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
That's why we're putting on, in other words, we're gathering a committee.
Amen.
Of men. I need men to help me do things in the church.
Amen.
Because I can't do it by myself.
Amen.
Amen. So we're putting a committee together to come up with ideas. Now again, women are welcome if they want to come and intercede and help us with ideas. Women have good ideas too, amen?
Amen.
So we encourage both men and women. But I'd rather, you know, right now we're going to gather some men together to help me do this stuff. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
So he says, "The job is too heavy for you to handle by yourself. Now listen to me. Let me give you a word of advice." See, this is a Torah teacher, a mentor, mentoring Moses. Amen? Nothing wrong with that. Okay? Now he says, "Let me give you a word of advice, and may God be with you." Listen to what I'm saying, and if you listen to what I'm saying, may God be with you. Amen? "Teach them God's decrees and give them his instructions."
Mm-hmm.
Not yours, Moses. His instructions, God's.
Right.
It says, "Show them how to conduct their lives, but select from all the people some capable, honest men who fear God and hate bribes." So you can't be part of my community if you like to play around with bribes.
Amen.
Right? "Appoint them as leaders over groups of 1,000 to 150 and 10. They should always be available to solve the people's common disputes, but have them bring the major cases to you. Let the leaders decide the smaller matters themselves. They will help you carry the load, making the task easier for you. If you follow this advice, and if God commands you to do so, then you will be able to endure the pressure, and all these people will go home in peace."
Amen.
Amen.
Amen? Because if I'm not at peace, you won't be either.
Amen.
No, that's not really true, but I'm not going to put it on you. All right. So everybody say Yitro. Yitro was what? Also a major player. Write that down. A major player in Moses' life. So in other words, now Moses' second wife after the death of Zipporah was only known as what? What was she? She was an Ethiopian. Also a black woman. All right? Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right? Now, the question is, how is it that so many people are blind to the fact, really, in the body of Christ, you'd be surprised how many people are so blinded about the black culture, the Spanish culture, you know, the German, the Italian, you know, they can relate. Just because, you know, you're from another country or from a different, you know, language barrier, because they have not been taught that every culture in the world is related to the Hebrew roots.
Amen.
Amen. Write that down. Every culture is related to the Hebrew roots.
Amen.
You'd be surprised how many of people coming into the Hebrew roots of their faith from different nations. We've had a lady a couple of years ago from Japan. She came to visit us. She was here on business, and she actually belonged to a small Hebrew roots kind of group. It wasn't even a synagogue. They met at their home in Japan, China, India, Africa, all over. I mean, Germany. They have what is called now Sicilian, or the Sicilian Jews are coming out of the woodwork in Sicily. And they're coming out, because again, how many of you know Italians, you know, they have their own recipes, they have their own way of cooking, and you know, most of them eat pork.
Yep.
Right? So now they're coming into the fact that, you know what, they created their own cookbooks, kosher cookbooks.
Amen.
Check this out. I just read this the other day. They are basically have recipes now, because how many of you know they like prosciutto? It looked, you know, I'll be honest with you, I used to eat a lot of prosciutto. But that's a very spicy, salty ham, okay? And it goes good with everything. Because I just love prosciutto. But now, they're making prosciutto out of goat. They're taking, now check this out. They have what is called duck bacon. Duck is kosher. Duck bacon, they say it is exquisite. Duck bacon, they have turkey bacon today, of course. They even have now beef bacon. I buy beef bacon in a place here in Western Chapel called Joe's Deli. The only place I know where they carry, and you can get it from New York, is called beef bacon. It tastes just like regular bacon. Amen? So you don't have to eat bacon. The reason I'm saying that is that I had this person that just got into the Hebrew roots of their faith, and they said, Rabbi, do I have to give up bacon? Because people love bacon. How many of you, come on, I do. But you don't have to eat that bacon. You could eat, again, kosher bacon, okay?
Amen.
So, and everything. You know, Puerto Ricans are known for making roast pork, right? Well, my kids were the first with that. We can't eat roast pork no more. You can't make the pork chops no more. Well, guess what? We learned how to make veal chops. Seasoned just the same way, tastes better, and it's better for you. I take beef roast, season it just like I would a roast pork, and it tastes the same. Right? And you eat it, some of you have eaten it. And I tell you what, it tastes good, right? But don't ask me to cook, because I don't have time to cook right now. I got a grandson to take care of. All right. Now, let's go back to this. I got about 5 more minutes. Everybody say, all cultures
are related
to the Hebrew roots.
So
it doesn't make a difference if you're Italian, German, Russian, I don't care where you're from. Everyone somehow, some way, is related to the Hebrew roots.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Now, I want you to write down spiritual stronghold. Spiritual stronghold, because we deal with this. As people, believers in Messiah, we deal with what is called spiritual strongholds. Now, spiritual strongholds has stopped the people of God of not seeing their true culture. Do you know that? Spiritual strongholds have kept people from not seeing their true identity or true culture. Now, let me say this. I would say that over 90% of the black culture don't know what I am talking about today. Mm-hmm. Come on. Am I saying that?
Amen.
In all the years, come on, let me ask you a question. In all the years you were in the traditional church, or even in the Pentecostal movement, or whatever movement you were part of, did any preacher ever get up and say, we have to study our history biblically and go into the study that I have been doing right now? Have you ever been to a congregation where they teach this?
No.
I don't see no hands written. Now, why? Because they did not know it themselves. And they cannot teach. The reason a lot of people cannot teach this is because they don't know it themselves.
Right. Amen.
A lot of pastors don't teach this, and when you try to bring it into the fold and try to teach them about it, they get offended, or they get standoffish, or they try to tell you you're wrong. And we're under grace,
bro.
But not under the law. And they don't understand the difference. Everybody say amen. Because they don't know themselves. Now why? Why did they not know it? Why have we been robbed in society? Pastors, great people in churches, why have we been robbed? Because, write this down, spiritual strongholds. It's a curse. It is a curse that has been passed down.
Amen.
And the curse is what? What is the curse? The curse is that you will forget your roots and where you truly came from. What more of a curse for people? There are people walking around not knowing who they really are in Messiah.
Amen.
Not knowing who they are.
Amen.
My Bible says that it's Joseph's coat of what?
Many colors.
Many colors. I like to say many cultures. And my culture, come on, say, in other words, this culture that we are going to work together. Everybody say, we're going to work together as culture. For what? For the glory of God. Say, for the glory of God.
Glory
and
God.
The God's kingdom.
God.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
In other words, turn to somebody and say, I want you to be excited for who you are. You got to be excited for who you are. Amen. I'm excited. You know, when I have an opportunity to share, don't ever get me started, man. I start teaching quickly anywhere. Amen?
Amen.
Now, in other words, it is a sad thing that, you know, most of the body of Christ, they don't really know who they really are. All they know is religion. And I want you to write this down about religion. Not to talk negative about it, but religion, you know what religion does more than anything?
Separates.
It divides. It's a form of division. And that's all it does. And you know what else it does? It creates lack and decrease.
Amen.
Instead of unifying, it separates us.
Yes.
All right? I was going to go into more of this black culture, but I'm out of time. We'll do another part next week. Is that okay?
Amen.
We're going to talk about, again, a little bit more about Moses, a little bit more about what's going on in his life, how we got where we are, what's going on with all this, so we can understand, again, the history of the Bible. How many of you have been enjoying this so far?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. How many of you have been educated or known something that you never knew before?
Amen.
Amen. Don't stop coming. Keep on learning. And get the CDs. If you missed a couple of these classes, get the CDs and catch up to where we left off. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right? And the reason also I'm getting into this more and more is because I think if you realize, you know, they are things happening in the world today, and there's talk about racial tension. How many of you have seen that?
Oh, yeah.
A lot of racial tension. And that racial tension, let me tell you something, is rooted from a spiritual stronghold.
Amen.
It is demonically inputted, and basically we have to know about that so we don't get caught up in that.
Amen.
And we could educate somebody else, hopefully to keep them from getting into it. Amen. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Because, you know, you'd be surprised. You know, well, they get very zealous, you know, and we have people that are getting radical, and we have to be radical for God.
Amen.
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 And not separate ourselves because of culture or race. Everybody say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
And that's something that I believe and praying that this new year, that, you know, even in the political system, in the world system, things will start changing for the better. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
So we don't get into all this stuff anymore. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right? Okay? We're going to pray just a little bit, but before we do, how did we do? I hope we did okay. Whew. So that's short, huh?
Yes.
All right. Well, I need you guys' help. If you can. Well, for some reason, I know this happens. We're still short $2,400 for our mortgage payment. We only got half, and we can't leave.